Hi, I'm Professor Melko, Chemistry PhD, and today we're going to do some practice problems and exercises on atomic notation, levels and sublevels, electron configurations, and orbitals. And this all falls sort of underneath the umbrella of different models of the atom, from Rutherford up through Bohr and quantum mechanics. So, let's get started. Let's start with this practice problem on atomic notation. Writing the atomic notation for an atom with 65 protons, 92 neutrons, and 65 electrons. If you recall, atomic notation looks something like this. The element symbol, I'll just symbolize with SY. The atomic number, sometimes we abbreviate that Z. And the mass number, which sometimes we write A. Okay, atomic number is the number of protons. So here with 65 protons, I know this is going to be the number of protons. A is the mass number. Remember, the mass number is protons plus neutrons, whereas the atomic number is just protons. So this superscript here is protons plus neutrons, so 92 and 65 looks like 157 is the sum of those two. 65 electrons doesn't really matter here for atomic notation. I'm going to assume over all this thing is neutral. 65 electrons and 65 protons, it's neutral. Okay, so now what is the element symbol? Well, remember, the element is defined by its number of protons. So for 65 protons, we would need to go to the periodic table. 65 looks like it is terbium, TB. So here's the atomic notation given this information. Let's try another one. Again, you can pause the video at any time and try these yourselves before you watch me solve them. Atomic notation, how many neutrons are there in this 4822 Ti? Ti is titanium, 22 protons. Remember, the number of neutrons is always that top number minus the bottom number. The difference between the mass number and atomic number is this number of neutrons. Here are the number of neutrons, abbreviating it N0, is the difference just 26. Up next, we're going to get into a little bit more of a difficult problem. Average atomic mass. The atomic masses listed on the periodic table are an average of all the isotopes of that element. That's why carbon's atomic mass is not just 12 on the periodic table, but slightly higher, because there's larger isotopes that pull that average mass away from just a carbon 12 mass. So we can determine the average atomic mass of silicon given the info below. There's three different isotopes, three different abundances for these three different masses. And here we use the weighted average approach. So I'm going to take each of these masses and multiply it by its corresponding abundance in decimal form. And I'm just going to add them all up. So 27.977 times 92% written as a decimal here. And then I'm going to add this to the other corresponding abundances and masses. Now I need a calculator. This best calculator known to man, the TI-83 plus, 27.977 times 0.9221. So I get 25.7975917 plus the second, 28.976 times 0.0470, 1.361872, plus the third isotope here, 9261966, adding up all these. I get a number of 28.0856. It says assume 4 sig figs, so I'm going to round this off to 28.09 for silicon. And just as a check, I'm going to make sure this mass makes sense. Okay, the most abundant isotope here is 28. Okay, so my final answer, since most silicon is this silicon 28, my final answer should be pretty close to this, since 92% of all silicon is that mass. The heavier isotopes should elevate this mass a little bit, and that's why I see this final mass 28.09 is a little bit higher, because these small abundances of the heavier things make the average a little bit higher than just the mass of 28. So that looks right. I might have made a slight calculation there, but everything more or less looks correct there. Okay, let's go on to the next one. Now we're going to get into energy levels and sublevels. So this is based on the Bohr model of the atom, where he first, you know, discussed this notion of electrons being in these discrete energy level orbits. How many electrons does energy level 3 hold? Think about it yourself and try to answer now. Energy level 3 means there's 3 sublevels. The number of the energy level is the number of sublevels. And the sublevels always are ordered S, P, D, F. So the first 3 there, S, P, and D, means there's an S, a P, and a D sublevel for this third energy level. S sublevels always hold 2 electrons. P sublevels always hold 6 electrons. D sublevels always hold 10 electrons. So the total in this entire energy level, we get by adding up all the sublevels. So the answer here should be 18 electrons. Answer D. We've also discussed in past lectures electron configurations. Here we're worried about the total number of electrons and describing where those electrons live within the atom. So asked here for a neutral cadmium atom, consulting the periodic table, we can see that cadmium has 48 electrons. So I'm going to have to write out quite a bit here, but I always start the same way. I identify the total number of electrons here, 48. And then I'm going to write out the sublevels in order that I've memorized them. 1s, 2s, 2p, 3s, 3p, 4s, 3d, 4p, 5s, 4d, and maybe I'll need more than that. We'll see. So now I'm going to start with these 48 electrons and start filling them in. 2 electrons, I always, of course, start with the lowest sublevel here, starting with this 1s sublevel, 2 electrons fit in there. 2s sublevel, it's an s sublevel, so 2 fit in there. P sublevel, 6 fit in there. S sublevel, 2, P, 6, S, 2, D, 10, P, 6, 5s, 2. So let's count how many electrons we have so far. 2 and 2 is 4, 6 is 10, another 10 for 20. 30, 38. So right now I'm at 38, which means I have 10 electrons left. Turns out all 10 can fit in this D sublevel. So here's my electron configuration. 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 4s2, 3d10, 4p6, 5s2, 4d10. We'll see in future lectures and practice problems, you can write an abbreviated electron configuration using the previous noble gas, but more on that later. If you don't want to memorize all these sublevel orderings, you can consult the periodic table and just sort of read through the elements counting up to 48. You have to go through the S block first, the 1S subblock first. Helium technically is a part of that right here. So moving sort of top to bottom and left to right, I go through 1S. Then I go through 2S block, then get to the P block, so that's 1S, 2S, I'm entering 2P. There's 6 of them there, so it's 2P6. Enter the third S block, go through 2 elements, 3S2. Keep going across, I then enter 3P, and there's 6 of them, 3P6. Next, I'm in the fourth row, 4S2, then I enter 3D10. 4s2, 3d10, then right here I enter 4p, 6 those, then I enter 5s, then I get to the 10th element in this d block, so it's no surprise that I end in 4d10. Okay, either way is totally fine. Orbitals. We also talked about in the previous lecture, this notion of quantum mechanics, meaning we can't know where an electron is exactly. We can only know its probability of being in a certain location or area or volume, I guess, to be most correct. And these volumes that are high probabilities, we call orbitals, right? And we have S spherical orbitals shaped like this, P peanut shaped orbitals shaped like this. So if I wanted to draw a 2P and 3P orbital, this might be my 2P orbital shaped like a peanut. 3P, as the energy level goes up, the orbital gets larger. So 3P, I would have to draw just as a larger form of that peanut. That's it. S orbital spherical, P orbital is P shaped. D orbitals, if you were asked to draw something like that, looks more like a clover leaf, like this. So that'll do it for the practice problems here. That sort of summarizes a lot of the different concepts when it comes to models of the atom, from Rutherford and atomic notation up through Bohr and sublevels and energy levels, then to the quantum mechanical model of Heisenberg and other quantum mechanic scientists that discovered the notion of orbitals and probabilities. So, as always, for more practice problem videos like this, you can subscribe to my channel on YouTube or check out my weekly office hours on Twitch, where I do practice problems like this, I review for exams, I answer whatever chemistry questions you might have that particular week, and from time to time we discuss science news like climate change, science and politics, and space. See you next time.